This is BBC Choice, where Julia's backstage and getting technical.
Hello, whatever happens in the next 30 minutes, please do not adjust your set. In fact, if you want anything adjusted, leave it to me. Excuse me, what about me? Oh yes, and she'll be helping as well.
Thank you.
Now, I've never really liked the colour of that top.
There's nothing wrong with it. I think we look good in this colour.
Yeah, well, it's just as well you're stuck in a television set then, isn't it? And I'm in control. Come on, boys, hit the buttons.
Ooh. Ooh, that feels really... Ooh, 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 ooh. Ooh, it's tingly. Ooh, I like having my colours done. Ooh.
That showed her who's boss. Silly cow. Hello, I'm Julia Bradbury. This is Backstage, coming to you live from the telecine area at Television Centre. If it's buttons that you want, then this is the place. Buttons galore, I tell you what. This is what's known as a grading suite. Don't ask me what that means, because I really don't know. But luckily, I'm in good company, because these guys do. Tim Emblem English is my lovely guide for the day. Tim, what a
Hello,
lovely
Julia.
Name.
Nice to meet you.
I do love your name, Mr. Emblem English.
Yes, I have my parents to thank for that.
You do, don't you? What lovely parents they must be. And Stuart Fifey, who's our technical expert. Stuart, hello.
Hello there.
So you're twiddling around here. Come
yep.
on. What do they all do, these marvellous buttons? We saw a little bit of magic at the beginning of the show.
Well, they're a bit like if you ever have a photograph from the lab and you're taking a Duff photograph, it's a bit like you can make all the colours come good again. So I have these little controls here that can adjust the colour balance and make it all look fabulous. This is a little bit of your programme last week.
Okay, this was us. We were coming
yep.
from the Holiday on Ice show last week. Very bad lighting we had there because, of course, it was just a big arena. We're at Wembley Arena, so we had no control. What have you done to try and improve our picture quality then?
Well, at the moment I can brighten it, just to whack it right up.
Oh, gosh, yeah, that's a little bit
like
too
that.
Bright.
I can make it all blue, make it like the X-Files, dark and moody and somber, or you can
dark
go
and moody
the other
we
way
like, don't we, Lucia?
Make it all nice,
yeah.
nice and warm and cosy.
So you can pretty much, you can improve picture quality, do technically really anything that I wanted you to?
You can do pretty much anything you want. If I get to the, there's a red tablecloth there,
yeah.
which is what we were doing earlier on.
Uh-huh.
You can isolate the colour and just attack just the tablecloth without
Incredible.
You know,
so you've got complete control
else.
Over certain areas.
Yeah. You can
now, Tim, this whole area is a very technical area.
Indeed,
and
yes.
we don't want to bamboozle everyone at home.
Yeah.
And I'm very stupid and I don't want to be bamboozled either. Mm-hmm. So aside from what you can do in this suite here,
yes.
what else can you do?
Right, this is where we transfer films to video for television use of all sorts, from blockbuster features to home movies to archive films dating back to the 20s, perhaps.
And so could I come in and do that here at the BBC?
Or
an independent producer?
Yes, certainly. We will do anything for anybody. Yes,
there
we are open
go.
To all comers.
That's the BBC. Now, before we move on and have another look around here, it's very exciting. Let's find out what else we've got in the show tonight. Back to Nature, the boy on a mission in a new BBC Two blockbuster. The face is familiar, but do you know the name? Well, we'll introduce you. And the Scotsman going to pot down Wembley Way.
Hi, I'm Simon Day and you're watching Backstage with BBC Choice. Ciao.
You certainly are. Now, as is Backstage's way, we like to have a little walk around the areas that we are. Tim is leading us now into a busy area. Chris Backman is a colourist. We'll find out what a colourist is in a moment. And can we have a bit of light in here, please, Chris? Thank you very much. And working with Chris today is Tim Robinson, a programme director of a BBC Two series called Seeing Salvation. Tell us a little bit about that first. The series.
Right, it's a four-part series presented by Neil McGregor, who's the director of the National Gallery in London. And it's looking at the life of Christ through artworks, paintings and sculptures, but also looking at their purpose, how people use them in festivals or in acts of worship. So there's quite a lot of sort of interviews in it as well. I mean, do you want me to tell you what each programme is about? The first one is about how did we get a portrait. This one is about the crucifixion and how it has lots of different meanings.
And so what can these guys here in this facility help you with? What are you doing right now? What's Chris helping you with?
Well, we get to the point where we put the pictures together again, which is called the conform.
Mm.
But the colour tends to be very sort of washed out. You've just got a colour which you haven't paid attention to. And then you can basically sort of choose the colours, I mean, according to really what you're trying to say with it. I mean, for instance, at the moment we're putting together a sequence which was a festival shot over a number of hours in Peru, where the light goes down very quickly because it's on the equator. So obviously you have shots shot at slightly different light conditions, so you can match
so you
them together.
So you want to try and even those out.
Yeah, so people don't notice the, you know, the fact that you're cutting together. But also you have various ideas. For instance, this is a festival of the Christ of the Earthquakes, where they scatter red flowers over him, which are the survival of a pre-Christian thing to do with mountain worship. These flowers grow on the mountains, the red flowers, but they also represent Christ's blood, so you want to bring out the red
of
that
colour.
But
flush.
At the same time, Chris can turn down, because some of the most powerful stuff is at night and you get a lot of red from the artificial lights. He can sort of turn that down but bring out the red of the flowers. So that people are basically looking at the right thing and know what it means.
Do you know? Is there a great temptation, because technology is now so advanced, for you to nitpick a bit as a producer and to want everything to look perfect? Whereas perhaps
I wouldn't call that nitpicking, I just call it doing a job properly.
But perhaps a few years ago, things would have been left perhaps a little more rough and ready. Not to say that you're not doing your job properly, but because now we are so advanced and we can do these things, do you think that more choice makes your job even more difficult?
I think it makes it more satisfying. But I mean, I haven't been doing it long enough to remember what it'd be like not to do it properly. Yes, it probably does. I think it's probably like medicine, isn't it? The more cures you have for illnesses that we would have accepted as fatal, like mistakes that one would have accepted as fatal in a program before and perhaps either not used the shot or just have lived with it. And we can now correct, for instance, if you want to mix between two objects, you can actually, not here, but you can alter the framing of it so that you can make the mix. And before, you just wouldn't have tried the mix at all. But I think that makes for a better program, which obviously, as I said, like medicine, it means.
Okay, just very quickly, we're gonna have to leave you now, unfortunately, because we've got to go next door and see what's going on there.
Okay.
How much work have you still got to do?
We've got another couple of hours worth, yep. We've got quite a bit to do,
So Chris, we better hunch back over those controls and get to it. Thanks very much, you two. Thanks for letting us interrupt
you. That's all right.
Now, we're moving now to another room. Come with me. I like the idea of this, Tim, because we're going to what's known as the spirit room.
Something very special and very expensive.
Oh, you see, I like both of those things, special and expensive. Those are possibly two of my favourite words. So here is the spirit room. Obviously, someone's got to it first.
Absolutely, yes.
And this is the special bit.
This is the spirit machine.
Okay, now this is the spirit machine. Yes. It's the SDC 2000. It's the latest edition for the BBC. Cost about £1 million if you fancy one at home. What does it do? 20 seconds.
This is a state-of-the-art CCD telecine machine, the best type of machine you can get for this sort of work.
So it transfers
transfers film to tape. 16mm and 35mm. Are we on your way? And does it in very, very high quality.
Got an expensive piece of kit there, and obviously security is very tight.
Indeed, yes. So
you don't want anyone.
You don't
want anyone walking off with that kind
of
equipment from the BBC.
No.
Let's go back out here now as well, because not only have you got lots of beautiful bits of machinery to look at, you've also got a fantastic view.
We do.
Of West London, which is nice.
Yes, and then we need a break. Rest their eyes, you can come out here and enjoy the view.
You can come and have a little breather, look at that. This is Julia Bradley reporting for The Flying Eye. This is the A40, Paddington's that way, Oxford is that way, and I can tell you traffic's bad, so stay right off there if you can. Now, another good bit of advice, don't ever play cards with that man.
I'll go £500.
Bloody hell.
You're bluffing, Parks. Right. I'll see you 500, I'll raise you 1,000.
Oh, my goodness.
You see, Peter, a little card on the boss's birthday, a bunch of flowers for the wife. You managers, you've got to be prepared to do whatever it takes these days. You're 1,000, and I will raise you 2,000.
Right. I'll see you 2,000.
Four aces.
I warned you, don't play cards with this man. The man is Stephen Moore. Stephen, thanks very much for coming on backstage.
A great pleasure.
Now, let's talk a little bit about The Peter Principle, which starts its second series tonight on BBC Two. First of all, where did the name come from?
The Peter Principle?
The Peter Principle.
I don't know.
Oh, I wondered if there was a little...
The Peter Principle, it's something to do with getting worse and worse at your job. Or
is it?
Yeah.
We can't relate to that at all in any way.
You're right personally.
No,
obviously not.
Absolutely,
I mean, that's
not
why I couldn't work out what it meant for a start.
Well, there we go. Geoffrey Parks, your character. Bit of a wet one, isn't he? Let's fix it.
Just a bit of a loser, would you say?
Yeah, I'd say just a little bit.
Yes, he has a sort of life of his own now. You know, if you look under stones, you see a lot of people like him.
So he's there in all guises wherever we look, really, you think?
I'm afraid so, yes.
Now, I know you don't... I know you don't mind me saying this, but everyone knows your face. No, you don't. Everybody knows your face, but a lot of people will find it hard to put a name with the face because we've seen you in such a great body of work, such a variety of stuff. I mean, what do people say when they come up to you on the street? What's the most common...
They say, what a great body of work. Basically, they say just what you say. I mean, people say, what were you in? You know, so I was at an airport.
And then you got to reel off your CV.
I'm very big in Safeways. They come up to me, are you famous? You know, and I say, no, not if you say that. But I was in an airport once. A bloke came up to me and said, just put your name on there, would you, for me? And I said, sorry, that. He said, thanks very much. He turned around and said, that's who it is. He said,
That's not very nice, is it?
It's all right.
No, we don't like that. Now, I've actually got a copy of your CV here because I've got a copy here. And we thought that what we'd do is basically give you a little bit of a test to see if you actually know a lot of the work that you've done.
All right.
Because if you're expecting people to come up to you in Safeways and know what you've been in, then you really should remember the stuff you've done in the past yourself.
Yes.
So
yes.
Question number one for
Sainsbury's you. Sainsbury's as well.
Of course. We'll start with some military questions. Who did you play in Soldier Soldier?
I played a brigadier, brigadier somebody.
You did play brigadier, Brigadier Chisholm you played.
Chisholm,
So Safeways, supermarkets, anyone out there, Brigadier Chisholm. In Countdown to War, your rank was reduced. Who did you play?
Countdown to War.
Can you remember that one?
Yeah,
can you remember that one, Stephen?
No, it's vivid, actually.
It's another army thing.
Yes.
Colonel Beck. He doesn't know anything. In which movie did you play Major Steele?
A Bridge Too Far.
Yeah, well done. In which TV series did you play Jack?
In which TV series did I play Jack? Rock Folly.
Yes! To the stage now. Who did you play in Twelfth Night?
Toby Bunch.
Yes. Which part did you play in the Threepenny Opera?
Mr. Peachum.
He's done pretty well, hasn't he? Actually, I think you've done very, very well considering everything that you've done.
Yes. And lots of soldiers.
What's the favourite role of all time so far?
Favourite role would be playing one of those Ibsen plays called Enemy of the People. I played Ian McKellen's brother. It's good fun. Went to LA with it and everything.
That's lovely.
Good
isn't it?
Gig.
Good gig, and we like a little bit of travel. But we can catch you now in the Peter Principle.
Oh.
Funny, stitches, make us laugh.
Enjoy.
Stephen Moore, we will. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Cheers,
pleasure.
Thank you. What a lovely man. Stephen Moore. Come on, guys, let's go back through here. Tim.
Yes.
Now, we're going to another little room now, aren't we?
Yes.
Because we're good at rooms. Tell me where we're going now.
We're going to Grading Suite 5. This is where, amongst other things, we handle amateur films.
Films that you and I would do.
Absolutely,
viewers.
Yes.
Okay.
So if we look in here.
Here we've got some gentlemen indeed. Now, David Murray is an independent producer who's today made a 600-mile round trip. He's paying the best half of £200 an hour to work on his footage here, and John Crane is the man who's helping him. Can we have a little bit of light in here, gentlemen? Sorry to interrupt you. Now, David, what are you working on?
We're working on a pre-war film from Ilkley.
From Ilkley?
The Royal Train in 1937.
And this is film that you've got hold of?
Yep, belongs to a guy in Yorkshire. We brought it down here because the BBC have the equipment and the expertise to do the transfer and get the best out of it. Put it onto video, and at some point it'll go out on a commercial video.
So, David, basically the BBC are guns for hire, and this is the place to come if you want a good job done.
And in this case, we are running 9.5mm film, which is a very old amateur standard, and I think we're one of the few places that can run it.
Are you finding particular problems with that because it's such an old film?
Very much so. I mean, it tends to fall apart on splices if it's been joined together. So fortunately,
which is
David,
not helpful, I would imagine.
Not really.
But we get back. David does check it all beforehand, so we don't have too many problems like that. But there's always the odd little rip and whatever. But these machines are very, very gentle with it, which is a good point. And then we can actually do all the corrections to get this. I mean, you can see on some of it, it's getting a little bit too dark. I'm playing it off tape now, so actually we can just see what we've got to do. And we make corrections to try and get the sort of uniform look all the way through it.
Now, David, trains are a part of your life, a big part of your life. They are, in fact, how you make your living. Just tell how it works. These are films that you put together and then sell through to retail.
The type of film we bring today, we put onto a master tape, and when we have enough film of the same area, we put it together like this one covers Edinburgh at Aberdeen in the 1960s and 70s, and we put that together and sell it through Smith's and transport bookshops and direct to the public.
Excellent. And have you made your millions yet?
Not quite.
That's a shame. I was going to ask you for your phone number. Thank you very much, David Murray and John Crane. Thanks
right,
a lot.
Cheers.
Get back to work.
Bye.
Now, I don't know. You see, boys, you love your trains and you love your rugby and you love your football, you love your sport, and some of you even make a living out of doing these things. I mean, you get paid to do your favourite hobby, just as this man does, Doogie Donnelly, sports presenter, commentator extraordinaire.
Julia,
Doogie.
What a pleasure.
What a pleasure to see you as well. And you come hot from snookerland, really, don't
Indeed,
you?
Indeed, Wembley.
Tell us all about it. Is it exciting, really, seeing those balls pocketed in the flesh?
Edge of the seat.
Is it really?
Yes, it's drama. Of course it is. Second most popular sport on television after football.
It is surprising. You see, that surprises me, that. But anyway, I'm not going to let my personal opinion colour this interview.
They told me you were passionate about sport.
I am passionate about sport.
They told me that,
in
yeah?
a big, big way. In fact, if we can get Ronnie, if Ronnie's watching, we'll try and get Ronnie. I've got a sporting question for you in a moment. Ronnie's got some Ronnie's got some equipment with him. Thanks. You're a sportsman. Can you work out what this is, Doogie? Because Lucia, our PA, showed it to us earlier on. And she said it was specially designed for some gym work of some kind.
I think you're absolutely right. It's a very difficult article to remove, in fact, under pressure.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But, and you should be careful because it's a shock absorber as well. You could be in real trouble. Doogie, I know that you mentioned the snooker. Last night you were working with your co-host, David Vine, and a little bit of a surprise happened
that
you were all in on. Tell everybody very quickly.
Well, what happened was Viney was presenting the quarter to seven programme, BBC Two. Hello, here we are. Welcome to Wembley Conference Centre. Big match tonight. And as he was in mid-floor, a gentleman with a big red book walked around the corner. Michael Aspel came in and gave it the old Viney. This is your life. And he was utterly gobsmacked.
He
it was
must
wonderful.
Have been.
Completely thrown. We all knew about it. We had to be in the secret because I had to take over the programme. It was
tell
great.
Me, you can give us some backstage gossip now on This Is Your Life, the workings of it. How far in advance did you know? And how do all the secret signals get given without the person knowing?
Well, they keep it really, really secret. They don't obviously want the subject to know. No. But because we were in on it and it was being done as a television programme within a television programme, then they had to tell those of us that needed to do television, pictures, sound, and I had to step in on that. But no, David knew nothing about it, and that was an achievement.
So he was completely surprised.
Completely surprised.
So that was a surprise for David Vine. What was the surprise of the snooker?
I suppose the defeat of John Higgins, who's the world number one, and a Scot.
Damn, you see?
But the consolation was he was beaten by still the most popular player in the world, Jimmy White. So Jimmy is sadly went out this afternoon.
Tell me, as a man who knows, I mean, when you're in that situation and you've got to shove the microphone under somebody's under somebody's mouth, who's just lost and it's probably breaking their heart, how do you do it sensitively and still manage to get the question in
the
that you need?
The snooker lads aren't too bad. I mean, the footballers, even rugby players, because it's a more physical sport, perhaps they're more hyped up. And even golfers, strangely, I've had some terrible tellings off from golfers at various times. But I think it's just sensitivity. There are some guys, Colin Montgomery's a great friend of mine, but I know the way Monty is, that there are days you don't go and stick a microphone under his nose when he's just missed a putt in the 18th.
So it's a little bit of judgment.
A little bit of experience and judgment, and hopefully if you know the guys, then you can feel that.
Question for you, Clyde, your football team.
My team, yeah.
Your team.
Yeah!
We tried very, very hard to get you a scarf as a bit of a thank you present for coming onto Backstage. We couldn't get one for love nor money in London anywhere.
What about the Clyde Supporters Club shop in Oxford Street?
I don't know. What about that?
It's
what
packed
about?
Every day of the week it's packed with people buying Clyde's. I can't believe that.
Of course.
They must
is.
Be closed on a Thursday.
Doogie Donnelly, maybe you should open a franchise. I think perhaps you should. Thanks very much. Good
pleasure,
luck with
Julia.
The rest
lovely
of your
to see
time.
You.
Nice
All
to
right.
see you as
Thanks
well.
Thanks a lot.
Now, new drama coming to your screens very, very soon. BBC Two starts next Monday. Four-part series called Nature Boy. This is the official BBC publicity pack, and this is what it says. Set against the harsh industrial landscapes and the dwindling pockets of natural beauty that characterise contemporary Britain. You know you want some. Oh, you know you do. Suits you, sir. The story is about a 16-year-old lad called David, who, when we first meet him, is living in a foster home up north. And the thing that keeps him sane and the thing that he's actually had from his father is a love of nature.
He decides that he is in fact going to set out to find the father who abandoned him when he was four. So he sets out at the end of the first episode to find his dad, and this is what drives the whole story. If this hadn't been the BBC, I don't think we would have been able to cast it the way we did, and I certainly wouldn't have been able to use a first-time director, which kind of made the project for us. We saw hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of boys and girls, in fact. In the end, we found Lee.
Before we started filming, I went to visit a guy who specialises in birds. So he was building up a sort of rapport with the parrot. So he got used to me, I got used to it. And otherwise it just bite you. And it bit me twice and it really hurt.
How'd you get him to do that? Won't bloody come near me.
They don't like you.
The same with the fox. I went to a small sort of farm. And again, just getting used to what it was like handling a fox, because this was very young. But the first time I sort of went naked was quite difficult, because, of course, you've got 20 people behind the camera. Well, 20-plus people behind the camera, so doffing off for the first time was quite difficult. But I managed it, and it was all right. And I can remember having to swim out away from the camera, and I was thinking, please shall cut. And then I heard cut, and I looked back, and we were so far away from the beach, I had to swim back in the cold, and naked.
My character is, she's 17, and she lives in the northeast, and her brother died from being in cement dust working in the factories. And so she campaigns against this, and she sort of bumps into this boy called David, and they kind of start a bit of a relationship, just the beginnings of one.
You know what, David?
What?
You're right, manky.
I was worried also when I came out of Coronation Street that I was going to get, everyone was going to think of me always as, I mean, oh, she's been in Coronation Street and that's all she can do, you know what I mean? And it was really nice to be given the chance to do this because it's just such a good part.
Who's it in?
My brother, Keith.
Won't he mind?
No, he won't mind. He died.
Oh. What did he die of?
Natural causes.
Different completely, something for now.
And now for something completely different.
Phil and Davina, here's your trio of intros for Junior.
Yeah, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. One, two, three.
Lights, please, Ronnie. Thank you very much. Here we are in darkness. Beautiful. Now, Jeremy Simmons is the associate producer of Nevermind the Buzzcocks. Well, so he says. And according to my research, he has an encyclopedic knowledge of music.
Not my words, but yeah, I'll endorse that.
Okay, that's what the notes say. Jeremy, we're going to give you a little test. You see, we reckon if your guests on Nevermind the Buzzcocks can do it, then so can you as a producer of the programme. So Ronnie and Martin are going to do their own mime of their own song. Take it away, guys.
Oh,
hold on a minute. Sorry, yeah, we need some sound. Hang on a minute. And now, that's it. Yep.
Ow. Easy.
Very easy.
Right, very easy.
I think All Right Now by Free.
Yes!
You are the man, Jeremy. What can I say? Now, let's talk a little bit about Mark Lamar, the cheeky chappie hosts the show. And what I want to know, has anyone been truly offended by what he said and refused to ever come back on the show?
Well, just before I started on the show, we had a slight problem with Lemmy, Motorhead. Big metal mother.
I can't believe that he'd get offended.
Yeah, well, he was offended by something that happened with the ID parade. Because we had Jay Aston from Bucks Fizz, if you remember her, many years ago.
Yeah.
In a lineup of blondes who were given a fairly were given fairly bad treatment by both teams. And Lemmy decided he did not take kindly to this.
Really?
He thought this was very sexist. And coming from him,
that's quite amazing, isn't it?
He stormed off the show after the credits had rolled.
And that, so I guess you won't.
So it had no effect at all.
You won't be inviting him back?
No.
No.
He won't be doing Lemmy again. Well, he wouldn't want to come.
I understand when Meatloaf came on the show, he'd never seen it, so you had to try and describe to him what the show was all about. So what we were going to do was a clever comedy gag and give you a Meatloaf to explain all about Nevermind the Buzzcocks. But we haven't got one, so we've got an apple instead. So can you tell us how you told
to this apple?
Yeah, explain to the apple what Nevermind the Buzzcocks is all about.
What is it all about? Well, first and foremost, it's all
about
entertainment.
And that's what you said to Meat, was it?
I did, yeah. Well, he doesn't really need to be told that. That guy
could,
well, you know, there's no point. You can't legislate for someone like him. He just does his own thing. And in fact, he was probably one of the few guests we've had who Mark actually got on with. Because he just gave, well, he gave more than was given. So.
Well, that's good. That's the kind of guest you want.
Well, yeah, not every week, but once a series.
How did your interest in music start? Because you're a complete buff, aren't you?
Yeah, well, anorak, whatever you want to call me.
I wouldn't call you an anorak.
No,
good.
Moment, thank you,
Jeremy.
how did it start? I don't know. I sort of got interested in music when I was quite young. I sort of grew up with sort of alternative scene, really. But I was always interested in it right across the board, and I just found myself like listening into the charts and watching Top of the Pops and Whistle Test, you name it. And for some reason, all this useless information stayed in my head. Anything that was of any use to me, like history or maths or whatever, just by the way.
Very overrated, I think.
I think so. Yeah.
Especially when you've ended up working on a music show.
Well, it's
having
the first
a great,
job.
Fantastic showbiz.
First and only job I've ever had where it's been of any use whatsoever. So
there will be many, I'm sure. You've worked on three series. Any new categories that are planned for the future now that you're sort of embedded there?
New rounds.
Yeah, new rounds.
Well, we can't possibly let the cat out of the bag there.
We've
had some new rounds over the last series.
Yeah.
Which you'll know about.
We've
and there have also
it.
Been one or two that have fallen by the wayside.
Very quickly, we're just going to give you a quick test of your knowledge of music, as you profess to be such a god.
Right.
Three
All
different
right.
songs, each with the same title, reached number one in 1984 for three different artists. What was the song and who were the performers? Three different songs, each with the same title, reached number one in
1984. Well, I think you're thinking of The Power of Love.
Yes!
But I should point out that one version of that didn't get to number one.
I knew he was going to correct
Have
us
on
I knew he was going to correct us
Have a word
something.
With your researchers.
Cue the VT.
here's another clip. That's so embarrassing.
Yes.
I think we're going to call this show Don't Watch This at Home.
And now for some proper music. This is the 1965 Eurovision Song Contest entry from Luxembourg. And you know what? Even more scary, this was the winner. We can't work out her name. What did we think her name was, boys? Max Bird or something?
That's the dumb mix, isn't it?
That is. I think we've definitely had enough of that. Let's get some lights on. There we go. Keep dancing, chaps. Nearly the end of the show. I'd like to say thanks to all of my guests. Thanks to Doogie Don. They can have the bra back. Thanks, Doogie. And Stephen Moore, Preta Principal. Very quickly, you remembered what it is.
The more incompetent you are, the more likely you are to get promoted. So
there you go.
You won't be head of BBC.
That's backstage. You're watching on BBC Choice. I'm Julia Bradbury. Thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
With son Frank fighting for his life and the love triangle deepening, a nightmare experience for Max in Casualty, next on BBC Choice.